So good afternoon, all the panelists and attendees for the Emerging Food Tech webinar series. The biggest challenge in every food processing industry that faces today is the lack of advancement and innovation in its manufacturing practices. To bridge this undergradation gap, we at Neologic have decided to present this Emerging Food Tech webinar series, where we talk about cost-effective food automations, applications of top-notch machinery technologies, current trends, and future directions in food processing sector, and much more. In this first series, first, we will be talking about the modernization and expansion of existing dairy plants. Few words about our today's distinguished speaker, Mr. Ravindra Mahajan. Born in middle-class family in Jalgaon, he started his entrepreneurial journey and his association with dairy at the early age of 13 when he started selling milk in early morning before going to school. B.Tech in Agriculture Engineering from Mahatma Phule Rishi Vidyapeeth, Rahuri in 1989. He completed his Master's in Dairy and Food Engineering from IIT Kharagpur in 1991. And since then, since last three decades, in the process of process engineering experience, including experience in Alfa Laval and Tetra Pak, he established his dream by founding Neologic with his fellow associate Rajendra Gore, who is also a panelist today, in 2007 to provide end-to-end solutions for various applications in dairy and food processing. Today at Neologic, we have dairy, prepared food, fruits and vegetable processing, beverages, and cosmetics as the main business verticals. Professionally, a hardcore technocrat, a PMP certified professional, having expertise in process design, process plant automation, dairy aseptic systems, project management, he has traveled to more than 30 countries and almost on all parts of India for his professional work. Neologic is the only authorized system integrator for Alfa Laval Pan India, having been chosen by Alfa Laval Denmark for its proficiency in dairy systems. It is also having partnership with two giants in their own field. One, Fenco Food Machinery for fruits and vegetable processing machinery, that is from Italy, and also Dima for cheese making machinery, again from Italy. As on today, Neologic has more than 300 installations across the globe and having all reputed brands like Mars International, Tasty Bite, PepsiCo, Hindustan Unilever, Dodla Dairy, Hatson, Heritage Dairy, Chitale Dairy, Danone, ITC, Dandy, Mother Dairy, Pearl Dairy, Amul, Nature Delight, Prabhat Dairy, Wadilal, Ridge Gravis, Parle Agro, Dabur, and the list goes on. Before I hand over to today's speaker, for all the attendees here today, since we have more than 100 attendees today, it will not be possible to unmute everyone at request. So I request to you to post your questions in the chat box or question answer window. And at the end of webinar, Mr. Mahajan will answer all those questions immediately, one by one. So ladies and gentlemen, let me present our speaker today, who is a firm believer of Karma Yoga, Mr. Ravindra Mahajan. Over to you, Mr. Mahajan.
Thank you, Sri Krishna, and a very warm welcome and good afternoon to all attendees. I'm really overwhelmed by your response. We had received more than 300 registrations and close to 200 have already joined. Unfortunately, we won't be able to allow you to open your unmute and talk to me directly because of time limit, but let me try to give justice for the time you have invested in this webinar. Thank you. So the flow of discussions today is going like this, that welcome and context setting has been already done by Sri Krishna. Then second point is why modernization, then why expansion of the dairy plant, and then challenges in modernization and expansion from the processor's point of view. So why modernization, basically? So Operation Flood has gone through different phases, phase one, phase two, phase three, where initially the animal husbandry work was done to a greatest extent. And in phase three, which was around 1985 to 1996, major investment in enhancing the dairy processing capacity was done by NDDB with great visionary Dr. Kurian's guidance. And those days, the World Bank also provided finance with government support. A lot of large dairies came up during that period. But those dairies are still running. Is it good news or bad news? Let's see. See, the equipment life issues are already cropping up. You see on my left side, on the right side of this presentation, there are these age-old plug valves which are suitable only to be kept in the museum, but 80% or 90% of the dairies still have those plug valves. Age-old equipments, separators, homogenizers, unfortunately, even today we are purchasing second-hand equipments which are 20, 30 year old, but are they adding value to us? So basically, the problem is energy inefficiency. If you consider an old homogenizer of 200 bar, 220 bar, we used to run at two stage. For example, 10 kilopascal homogenizer used to consume 75 kilowatt power. Today, with nano valves and with high efficient valves, at 160 bar, 150 bar, we can run the homogenizer with the same homogenization efficiency at 52 kilowatt. And in case of separator also, 20,000 liter self-cleaning separator, that is what I have shown in picture. Similar separators are consuming 50 HP motor, 50 HP. And today's the same kind of homogenizer, self-cleaning type, consumes just 30 HP. So it is a huge loss of running the old equipments as such. Technological upgradation of these equipments is not possible. These are not upgradable. You can't upgrade their control system. Then we have high processing cost per unit because of these guzzlers, energy guzzlers, and we are bleeding money every day. Perishable industry has another risk that because of these age-old equipments, we have high and frequent breakdowns. The breakdowns are costly and breakdowns are frequent. Then what happens? Can we go back to the original manufacturer? No. They will say that they have already phased out these equipments. The spare parts and expertise is not available. And then the dairy engineers or dairy experts have to go to the obsolete and spurious spares. And when you start using spurious and obsolete spares, again you land into a frequent background and the vicious cycle continues. Another problem is the old equipments are not suitable for capturing data. So we are mainly dependent on logbook readings, writing by the operator. Then our HSCCP parameters are totally in control of the operator's sincerity. If you tell him to write in 5 minutes or 15 minutes, he will religiously fill up the data, but who knows how many times he went near the equipment and have taken the proper readings. So our product safety is at the cost of sincerity or insincerity of operator. Then utilities monitoring. We also don't know how many times the utilities have gone down or the pressure, steam pressure has gone down. What was the temperature of the chilled water? Why the milk outlet temperature was not 4 degrees? How many alarms have come? What corrective actions the operator have taken? Everything is in dark. And we have to live with this situation if you do not modernize. Another challenge is when those plants were designed 25, 30 years ago, maybe the initial design was done properly, religiously, even though it was a manual plant, maybe proper CIP care was taken. But the dairies have gone into a big transformation. A plant which was designed those days for 50,000 liter is handling maybe 3 lakh liter dairy, milk per day. So a lot of additions have happened, pasteurizers, pumps, silos, maybe entire set of silos is changed from less capacity to bigger capacity. And who has kept the track of whether the piping is hygienic or not? You see on the slide, typical flow plates I see still in many plants. How can somebody ensure and confidently say that all the swing bends of the flow plate have undergone proper CIP, and whether CIP is done properly or CIP system is also having proper HACCP parameters. Then we have another challenge, that is product losses. The higher the product losses because of uncontrolled water flushes, either too much of water will enter into the milk or too much of milk gets drained through the valves and flow plates. And the higher the losses means higher the load on ETP. The higher load on ETP means we have actually higher consumption of water. So we should control water consumption. We should control ETP load. If we do not control, then we have big challenges because we have now very stringent norms from every state pollution control board for zero discharge policies. And this adds a big headache for all the dairy processors. I don't have to explain more because you might have experienced such challenges. Growing demand on MIS report as well as on integration with IoT. I'm sure that for the billing purpose, from the cooperative societies, from the producers, when the milk is collected, many dairies have invested in proper systems, IoT system, SAP-based systems for billing purpose. Similarly, such systems are there for distribution network also and logistics also, because you are connected with thousands of producers as well as thousands of distributors. So there IoT and SAP was a big demand. But what happens in between? The product, which is main product and processing area, that if is not automated, then you do not have any MIS report as to how safe the production is done. You can see typical reports generated through automation, and you will experience that these reports are operator independent. So the operator doesn't have chance to manipulate anything. Why modernization again is a mismatch of automation? Since we are going to add newer equipments to enhance the capacity, but enhancing capacity is not enough. Suppose you have on top there is a very basic milk pasteurizer with push button stations, and there is another pasteurizer with PLC. So in the same plant you have both the units, because you are so fond of your old equipment that you don't want to get rid of it because it is performing. Management doesn't allow to scrap it, but operator is totally confused whether he should follow a PLC control equipment protocol or he should follow a basic protocol. And the same operator has to approach both the things, and he is bound to make mistakes. And it will be very confusing work instructions. High dependency on operators' skills and sincerity. I have again and again explained that since the reports are not there, then it is totally dependent on operator how he ensures product safety and CIP safety. Why expansion? So it's quite natural. When you are going for modernization, you'll also look out for expansion. To fulfill growing market demand, see, we are in such a fortunate industry where there is really no recession. And we have always growth because of the high urbanization, high purchasing power. I don't want to go into detail of those points because it is out of context here. But I am sure that every industry like yours has a growth aspiration, and we have to grow in volumes. And typically, dairy industry, the growth happens in multiple times. So when we do expansion, when we have growing market demand, then sometimes we do expansion because apart from making your own product, you also want to establish a spare capacity so that you can engage yourself with co-packing opportunities of big brands. There are brands like Nestle, Britannia, Danone, and many more. Those international brands are ready to get associated with very reliable and very disciplined processors. And they have a team of experts. These people, they visit your establishment. They do their own hygienic analysis. And based on their analysis, based on their recommendations, only the open for this kind of activity. Expansion is also needed when you decide to widen your product horizon. When you want to provide more different products in your product basket to consumer. And these are value-added products like paneer, cheese, and different types of curd, yogurt. Then to reduce working hours. Sometimes you may not have expansion plan because of just increasing the capacity. But sometimes you want to streamline your working hours. For example, in packing, most of the dairies have highest number of laborers working there. And if the operation goes beyond two shifts, it's a big challenge to manage the packing area. So many times it is advisable and desirable to put up more equipments like packing machines. Maybe sometimes the CIP is not enough for added number of silos and tanks and lines. So you do expansion by way of adding CIP systems. So that is another area. Then diversification into products such as dairy, expanding into juice and yogurt. See, all dairy plants are well equipped, definitely, with all types of utilities like refrigeration system, chilled water system, cold stores, boiler, compressed air, electricals, and all types of logistics is already in place. So it is quite natural that you want to expand or diversify into yogurt-based products. Flavored yogurts are quite popular. And also sometimes if the dairy already has an aseptic plant, then aseptic plant is a heavy investment and you would like to utilize your packing investment in an effective way. So some dairies would also like to do a co-packing of juices. And again, the same topic, that to meet quality demands of export market. Since export market, like suppose somebody wants to export even Indian sweets or Indian dairy products to USA, there are some certifications required, some audits are happening. And to fulfill those audits, we have to ensure that in our processing system, proper food safety standards are followed, and our equipments, our SCADA reports, our MIS system support all our data, and we can provide the traceability of each batch. So to do expansion, naturally, you will look into the change of the functionality, maybe from very basic manual plant to automated plant. I would not say that all automated plants are essential, because a very small capacity automation may not give you the proper return on investment. But when we are doing expansion, that time if we can do at least the automation of liquid milk area and area where there are multiple operations, we can get advantage of following functions, that is queuing function. Means operator doesn't have to select tanks in queue. Once tank A is empty, tank B can get in line immediately. Similarly, for the filling operation, it can happen. There are safety interlocks, which will recover the product and reduce the product losses. It will also reduce the water losses. Alarm handling, whatever alarms are there, operator cannot hide the alarms. Alarms, he must have to acknowledge, and then only he can go ahead. He cannot stop the process in between without handling the problems. Event log, if some event has happened or some critical alarm has happened and operator has not attended it, that will also come out in SCADA reports. Errors will come out in the SCADA report. We have different password settings in the automation so that particular operator will be given particular password. So whatever operations he do with his login will be traced to his activity. Similarly, the operator will have different password level. Manager will have different password level. Programmer will have different password level. So operator cannot play along with the system, reduce the some critical CIP timing or something. They have to complete the CIP and critical operations in the stipulated way only. And last is also very important, that equipment status is always maintained. Operator can never make a mistake by again filling up the tank, which was not cleaned previously. So once the tank CIP cleaning is done, operator can then only load the tank for the next production batch. So all these functionalities you get at the time of expansion and modernization. So when I travel to the dairy, I see a lot of such pictures because of too much of flexibility. If you give a chance to the normal dairy operator in a conventional plant, he would like milk to be taken from any tank to any tank. He wants to utilize even the raw milk tanks as a pasteurized milk tank, even the pasteurized milk tanks as a curd tank. And this is the end result. Then you end up with all floating piping, and those pipes are stacked, never cleaned properly. This is another problem. Our famous plug valves are a big culprit in unhygienic design. There are too many dead ends. Typically, sometimes milk piping is done like a water piping, conventional water piping, which ensures that there are all problems related with not only with the product losses, but also with unhygienic dead ends. There are certain installations where the valves and some instruments and some control features are hidden under the tank and at in an unapproachable level. Operator cannot really have a good access to it. So he sometimes have a tendency to avoid cleaning, physical cleaning of those unapproachable areas. These are the kind of flow plates when you want to do too much of flexibility. Everywhere you want to take milk from just one area. So we need to have a proper discipline and thought process in place as to how we want to utilize our equipment. So really the transformation should happen in the dairy industry from this level to the fully automated level. I won't say that every plant should be again fully automated, but the kind of construction that we can ensure is totally different with expansion. This is what I was saying as a classical example here, that see in the photograph, this is a small ice cream unit which has flow plates. There are, you see valves only on the top for the product and CIP line, but after the tanks, the entire piping is based on flow plates. But in flow plates also, we have ensured that there are absolutely no dead ends. And we are also ensuring that proper bend is connected. If you see in the photograph, there are proximity switches to ensure that the bend is not accidentally connected to CIP when you want to do production. So basic product safety is taken care of even in a manual plant. This is a curd plant. This kind of control room is there. In a fully automated plant, you don't have to have people running around doing a valve operation. They just have to select route from which tank, through which pasteurizer or through which chiller. And it happens. If there is any error in the mechanical opening of the valve, they come to know. Let's see what are the challenges in modernization and expansion. Everybody wants to have a very modern and ultra-modern plant. But what are the challenges? What are the mind blocks in going for modernization? The first challenge that we have to overcome is shift of mindset. Modernization is something which is not going to be enforced by somebody. No government department or no sanitary agency or a sanitary inspector is going to come and inform us that this is the deadline and by this date you have to completely transform your plant. We have to decide ourselves that yes, now the plant life is over, and I have to go for more energy efficient system. Ignoring its need will lead to extinction, because ultimately your production cost will increase, market complaints will increase, and it is a risk to the brand. Another negative point for engineering industry is that all the reputed industries are interested in low-hanging fruits like greenfield projects. Everybody wants to do a mega project and big projects with greenfield operations so that the slate is clean and they can work easily on a brand new equipment and brand new project. But when you want to go for modernization, then engineering companies also have to put in a lot of efforts, and the resistance comes because how can I do the modernization in the same place, in the same location, without stopping a dairy, because I have to run dairy for 365 days. But that is where we have to do micro planning. We have to break down the challenge into small, small baby steps. And those steps and that micro planning is very critical, and it is a teamwork. No engineering company cannot can work independently unless and until there is a fantastic teamwork of the end user as well as the engineer. But and I am proud to say that in last one year itself, we have done 4 such modernization projects in South India. Another challenge is always space limitation, because now space is costly, but to buy additional land just next to your dairy is not possible. But then we have handled such cases also. I can tell you the classic example of Sangam Dairy. Sangam Dairy has a beautiful plant or a campus. It was built in 1972. And it was done in a very classic way, in typical NDDB standard. But today, when they have to modernize that plant, which was built for 2 lakh liter, they are already running it at almost at 6 lakh liter. And they have to do the expansion to 8 lakh and 12 lakh liter. It was a big challenge. Where will the space come? But when we did a micro planning, we can ensure that the additional civil requirement is just 20%. Of the greenfield project. So next challenge is fear of operator's failure. Everyone thinks that since it is a complicated thing, it happens on a computer and it is very difficult for operators to operate. But that's not true. Actually, operator need not be expert on automation. They should know what command they are giving and what exactly happens in the plant. So we have to spend or invest more time in training the operators initially. And you see in this picture, these operators, they were regular dairy diploma people. They were operating conventional plant. When they came to our office and played like a video game with the system by running different commands, by understanding different logics. When we commissioned the plant, they were very enthusiastic to learn all the alarms and all the parameters. And when the plant commissioning was done, within 8 days, they completely took over the operations. So it's not true that you require very high competence. And fear of losing production flexibility. But in fact, we have to ask ourselves, how much flexibility we really need? Can I make a completely new line, dedicated line, because I may need it sometimes, 1 or 2 times in a year. Friends, any pipeline which is idle and not used and just built for flexibility is adding a hygiene risk. And it is a strictly no-no. So we have to do a proper analysis, proper planning of our production processes, and then decide what flexibility we need. ROI of investment not done properly. Many times we are having an impression that automation plants are extremely costly and they add burden to my overall capital and overall problems, because I may not get the return on investment. But I can tell you with our case studies, when we conducted case study of 2 lakh liter and 4 lakh liter dairies, we did costing for both the dairies, and we found out that the additional investment between a conventional plant and a fully automated liquid milk plant, I'm talking about, is not substantial. And whatever investment is done, that investment has a payback of 3.5 to 4 years only by way of saving different things like utility saving, water saving, ETP chemical saving, product losses, market complaints, market recall. If we add everything, then it is 3.5 years to 4 years. It's quite exciting. So I have completed today's topics. Let us have a recap quickly. Why modernization? You may, while discussing and while I am talking, maybe you might have come up with your own case studies, with your own challenges, and with your own pointers, why modernization is essential in your dairy plant, why expansion is essential in your dairy plant. Basically, modernization is required, again, to recap, to have an energy efficient system, to have a safe production, to have traceability of production, why expansion, to enhance product basket, to enhance production processing capacity, to grab the opportunity of co-packing, and to increase our productivity of the equipments. Challenges in modernization, as you know very well, that modernization and expansion is the key for growth of the business. And even though we say that dairy industry works on a thin margin, actually we have to be very, very, very alert in controlling our losses. So controlling our losses, or a rupee saved is rupee gained. That's the key in going for modernization and expansion. Thank you for your patient hearing. Just to introduce you, that Neologic has different business verticals. Dairy and beverage are the two main areas, bread and butter for us, which goes more, gives us more than 50% revenue. We are also active in ready-to-eat food products, where we have recently supplied quite large complete factory for Mars International in USA, where they are going to make different types of curries and ready-to-eat Indian products. We have a very good association with Penco Italy for fruits and vegetable business, for tomato ketchup lines, and all different kinds of drinks and soft drinks, carbonated soft drinks also. Then we are providing some solutions of mixing and cleaning for pharma industry. We are very active in cosmetics industry. We have supplied several systems for Unilever as well as for L'Oreal. In dairy, of course, we do almost everything rather than making our own homogenizer and separator. Maximum equipments are made by us with help from Alfa Laval. Alfa Laval is our backbone in providing the thermal design and PHEs and components. Aseptic milk processing, we have made for the first time such systems are working. We are preferred aseptic system supplier for PepsiCo. Technological upgradation, we have undertaken, as I have mentioned to you, many plant upgradations and transformations we have done, expansions we have done, and greenfield projects. So please join our upcoming webinars, IoT Ready Food Industry. And of course, from time and again, since you have registered for this webinar, you will receive timely communication from our side for reminding you to join these webinars. Sri Krishna, can we go for a question and answer session, please?
Yes, yes. So before we go to question answer session, I have a big takeaway from this session. One sentence which I will remember always is, every rupee saved is every rupee gained. So thank you so much for that, Mr. Mahajan. And I will start with the question answer session. So one common question which is appearing in most of the people's mind, I can tell you, sir, is, can we make the expansion without losing any daily production?
Yes, of course, we can do expansion. As I said, that it requires micro planning. Means we have to do a micro planning section by section wise. We can't say that over a night we can go from system A to system B. And it's not a fixed formula, actually. Every dairy is unique. I have done maybe it's the design in my career, more than 100-150 dairies. I have lost count, but no plant was same. Every time there was different challenges in every project. Every project is unique. Challenges are unique, but I can confidently say that it is possible, and we have to do a microfilming for that.
Okay, thank you. So next question is from Surbhi Khajanchi. How can a traceability through MIS, can we provide some insights? So what is the traceability possibility through MIS?
Yes, basically traceability is not a new thing in the world. It is already a norm in Europe. All the automation designs, whether you have a Rockwell system, Allen Bradley Rockwell system, or Siemens system, or Schneider, all systems are now designed on AS88 and AS95 platform. And now they have to follow that logic or some discipline in making up the software logic. And that software logic ensures that you can trace back which batch of milk was packed when, from which silo, and that silo was filled from which pasteurizer, and during those pasteurization hours, what were the alarms. So that kind of traceability is possible very much in our automation. And in Neologic, even though customer do not ask, we have made ourselves ready for that kind of traceability linked softwares.
Okay. Next question is from Mr. Mohammed Abdul Kalam Azad from Azad Dairy Milkweta, Bangladesh.
Yeah.
How we can synchronize this particular modernization or expansion in terms of financial point of view? I think this needs to be answered in detail. Correct, sir?
Yes, exactly. Because as I said, every plant is unique. So every plant will have different types of requirements. So if you are going for modernization, then up to what level? What is the quality of the vessels and equipment, pasteurizers that you have, whether those are upgradable? And how much additional investment is required? So for a greenfield project, financials can be worked out in terms of some budget figures. But for an existing dairy, we have to really deep dive into it, and then only we can comment on the financials.
Okay.
I think Mr. Mahajan, maybe his question is more related with the ROI. So
yes, as I have mentioned, for a greenfield project, the ROI of additional investment of automation is between 3.5 to 4 years. And I am not counting the damage that happens to your reputation or brand because of market recalls.
Okay. So there are two questions which I am combining. Do you also take complete turnkey projects in dairy? And the same another question is, are you supplying African countries? So these questions are from Bhimappa Manthale and Ramkrishna Padmarao.
Thank you for asking these questions. Actually, this is the point which I missed. Yes, we are known for complete turnkey solutions in dairies. And please visit our website at www.neologicengineers.com, and you will find more details about our projects and ongoing activities. And your second question is whether we supply equipments to Africa. So far, we have executed close to 10 projects in Africa, particularly in Uganda, Kenya, Zambia, Zimbabwe. Even we have put up plants in Morocco and then Dubai. So far, Neologic has set up complete projects in 16 countries, including USA and Sri Lanka, Bangladesh.
Okay. Next question is from Varad Milk and Milk Products. What are the byproducts, machinery, as well as manufacturing technology that we can provide?
We have all the standard byproducts, machinery available, like paneer, butter, then yogurt, curd, lassi, buttermilk, even your mishti dahi. And we also have association with Dima for cheese lines.
Okay.
The only thing that we do not do is we do not make powder plants.
Okay. Next question is from Nandakumar Selvan. He is asking if the power would shut down during the processing of milk in homogenizer, that time we need to release the pressure. If we not release the pressure, what will happen?
If it is a manual plant, definitely you have to release the pressure. And if it is a if it is a modern homogenizer, definitely once the power goes up, the hydraulic power pack also loses the pressure, and that kind of safety is very easy to build in modern homogenizer. But if you have old homogenizer with manual pressure adjustment, then it is essential to release the pressure.
So I think this point also highlights why modernization is essential.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Question from Mr. Rachel Steven. Are you open for trial runs for plant-based milks such as pea and lupin?
Thank you, Mr. Rachel. Actually, we do not have a full-fledged technology center here in Pune to try the product in Pune. But yes, we can discuss this specifically, and maybe we can convince some of our customers to conduct such kind of trials at their place.
Okay. Okay. Next question from Shikhar Srivastava. Does Neologic work in the field of agricultural farming?
Though I am a B.Tech in agriculture engineering, I would say that we have narrowed down our activity towards processing industry.
Okay.
I would love to do that, but won't find time.
Okay. Next question again from Mr. Shikhar Srivastava. What will be the funding provided by the government for the startups in the field of agricultural farming? I think this is more related to the government subsidies and government funding.
Yeah.
Question from Varad Milk and Milk Products. For a 50,000 liters per day dairy, with byproducts such as paneer, curd, cheese, and flavored milk, and such non-frozen products, would it be cost effective to go for modernization, automation, or just monitoring process control parameters is enough?
Basically, I would answer this question in two steps. See, I come across so many dairy entrepreneurs that they have 10,000 liter, 15,000, 20, 50,000 liter milk, and they want to make all kinds of products. But I actually discourage such thing, because first we have to make our food strong in the dairy industry. We should see that we are good at delivering fresh milk, making some paneer curd, and cheese and flavored milk and other products, value-added products, should be in your phase two. No dairy should start with all types of byproducts in first go. That's my first point. And then a second point is, if your equipments like daily processing capacity of paneer, cheese, and all that is quite small, then modernization can be limited, or process control can be limited up to the critical process control points only. Means I would not suggest that you have automatic paneer block cutting and paneer packing machines and all those things. But definitely, the milk which is going for heating for paneer must have a proper monitoring and automation.
Okay. So before we go to next question, to all the attendees, request you to put your questions in QA box, not in the chat box, so that we can take one by one. Next question is from Bharat Chaudhary. How much is the scope for IoT Industry 4.0 in dairy process automation or modernization?
Sure. Definitely there is a lot of scope, and all dairies, even the instrumentation, the level of automation, and the level of integration that we have with automation system with external SAP based system is quite common, and it can be worked out on case to case basis.
Okay. Another question from Varad Milk and Milk Products is your technical representative accessible for the technical discussion? So yes, we will be getting in touch with you, Varad Milk. Next question is from Ravindra Kadam. Please advise your experience on maintaining automation systems.
Maintenance of automation system, I would break it into two things. One is the maintenance of mechanical maintenance and instrumentation maintenance, which is quite logical, and you have to do anyhow. And maintenance on automation system is actually quite less, and it can be handled remotely if there are some critical issues like burnout of cards or something. Then we have to address the root cause problem and address it accordingly. But as such, the frequent failures of automation PLC system or data server and all those things is quite uncommon. It is quite rare. So we have to basically maintain the instrumentation and our valves functioning and mechanical functioning in automation.
Next question is from Pramod Tambade. It is about the powder plant. So Mr. Mahajan has already explained that we are not into powder, but I'll just read the question. If powder plant is PLC operated, all valves and damper and almost all things are manual or semi-automatic, can you convert this to SCADA operated with logic and efficient capacity?
Yes, there are companies which are now going for a highly automated powder plants. It is also possible with high-tech predictive control, so that the predictive control takes the action in advance before the parameters go out of control or out of range. So quite a lot of work has been done already in powder plant automation levels. And you can discuss that whenever you order the equipments for that.
The next question is from Mr. Shyam Kohli. For 1 lakh liter per day liquid milk plant, what will be the approximately cost for the modernization?
Actually, I cannot say just a ballpark figure because we have to understand how many tanks and how many process lines you have. So accordingly, we have to make some sort of estimate. And to make that kind of estimate, we have to spend at least 30-40 hours of engineering to understand your specific requirement. So if you can share your installed plant details, like number of lines, number of silos, number of packing lines, all those details, then we can arrive at some ballpark figure or some budget figure.
Mahajan sir, can we have the slide where we have our contact details mentioned, email address? So that's right, yeah. Because next question is also related to that. Yeah, this last one, yeah. So next question is the technical service contact number. So you can note down or take a photo of this particular slide and you can get in touch with our people. Neeraj Awasthi has mentioned that we are trying to install new plant in Eastern UP. So Neeraj sir, my request is type your details in the chat box and we'll try to get back in touch with you.
Lakshman Rao sir has asked one question about the pasteurizer efficiency.
Yeah.
Lakshman Rao sir, the pasteurizer efficiency is quite common to design between 90 to 93%. And initially, the design has to be done to ensure a minimum 90% efficiency for regular milk pasteurizer. But if it is cream pasteurizer, then the efficiency has to be worked on case-to-case basis.
Okay. Next question is from Amol Patil. Dairy sector is growing 10 to 10% annually. So this growth is pertaining to liquid-based plants or SMP blades-based plants?
It is in both areas, actually. Basically, definitely, the liquid, once the milk comes to the dairy, there has to be a good liquid milk plant. There only it can go, the milk can go for a powder plant. So dedicated powder plant based dairies are quite few and not so common. So any liquid milk plant is an integrated unit.
Okay.
And mostly SMP business, as you know, has lots of ups and downs. And so I don't think any dairy processor will exclusively depend on only SMP based investments.
Okay. Next question is from Mr. Raghavendra RT. Sir, our existing plant, Dodla Dairy Koppal, is having SCADA for pasteurizer and CIP, but we don't have data acquisition facility for data analysis. Can you help us?
Yes, of course. Our engineer will talk to you specifically to address your issue and we'll understand what is the missing linkages between the data acquisition in the report stream software.
Okay. Then we have Nagari Nagari. Good evening. As told you, new equipment is energy efficient. Is there any benchmark as kilowatt handling for 1 KL, 1,000 liters milk handling liquid packing?
We cannot directly relate it only with electrical. As such, we have to work out total cost of processing. And that will involve your ETP cost, chemical cost, water cost, everything.
Okay.
Because mainly the energy required, electrical energy required in any dairy plant is maximum energy consumption is in refrigeration side.
Okay. Next question is from Mr. Abhishek Apte. Can SCADA system be used only in fully automated plants?
Sorry, can you repeat it, please?
So Abhishek Apte, he has asked that can SCADA system be used only in fully automated plants?
SCADA system is generally recommended only in fully automated plants, but SCADA system you can use to capture the data and create MIS even in a semi-automatic plant where you have PLC-based pasteurizer and PLC-based CIP, and the tanks are equipped with instrumentation, then you can still get the SCADA reports respective to those instrument signals.
Okay. Next question is from Shubhra Jyoti Mandal. Can mixing of milk due to wall leakage from milk in CIP recovery tank can be traced?
Yes, it can be traced by turbidity meter, but it is doing the fault finding after the accident has happened. I would say that we should first analyze the problem, because okay, turbidity is possible to detect that the CIP solution turbidity has suddenly changed, and then milk losses are coming to the CIP.
Okay. Next question is from Shreyans Shetty. As an industry thought leader, what is your perspective for the end of line automation in dairy industry?
End of line automation is not so common, but there is a big future for end of line automation, because manpower is becoming costly, and as I am saying, that dependency on manpower in all sectors is going to be a challenge. So definitely there is a lot of growth and good prospects for end of line automation.
Okay. Another question from Mr. J. Rajashekhar. Sir, are you supplying flavored milk line?
Yes, of course.
Yes.
Question. But we do not make packing machine of and sterilizer, but we can help you to even select those kind of equipment.
Yes. Next question from BN Kumar Thikkaddi. Automation is updating day by day. Some of the parts like PLCs are not available in the market. How can we overcome this?
Can you repeat it, please?
I will repeat the question. So question from BK Kumar Thikkaddi. Automation is updating day by day, and some of the PLC cards are now not available in the market. So how we can overcome this?
Oh, that is a big problem, actually. As you say, that when we started using computers, those days we had totally different motherboards and different hardware. We can't get replacement of that. Similar problem is here also, that you can't get the replacement of the old cards. It is better that we ship that much of package of the PLC into new generation PLC. And I can tell you that it is not very, very costly. Since you already have necessary instrumentation, you already have necessary hardware for automation, then only replacement of PLC and software programming is not a very big challenge.
Okay. Next question is from Omkarash Barure. Do you also undertake IoT integration along with OEM?
Yes, we can have a very close contact with the other OEMs, and we ensure that our system is upgradable and communicatable with other suppliers.
Okay. Another interesting question from Mr. J. Rajashekhar. Is there any pasteurizer with more than 93% efficiency?
Oh, yes. This is also a very good question, I would say. Adding efficiency in terms of percentage after 90% of in the pasteurization efficiency, 90, 93 and all that, actually you end up into a vicious cycle that if you aim for higher thermal efficiency, then you intend to provide more heat transfer area. More heat transfer area adds to your lot of pressure drops in the system, and that again adds to your pumping cost. You have to go for higher HP pumps and higher investments. Your initial investment is higher, then your pumping and electrical consumption is higher. So it comes back to one and the same thing. So beyond 93%, it's not advisable to try. Even in European countries, they do not go beyond 93%.
As of this is a very, very important point and very valid point, yeah. Next question is from Baba Baldand. Actually, we have Neologic CIP system. One system is showing correct data and actual object is different. Some different details are coming. So possible to have corrective action online.
Okay. We can take it up as a specific case, and we have to analyze what additions and deletions in the equipments are done, or some program software changes were done latest.
Okay. Do you consult for planning? This question from Prithviraj B. Do you consult for planning of new micro dairy plant with milk, curd, paneer, butter, ghee?
Yes, we can guide actually for micro dairies, but I do not suggest that all micro dairies should be equipped with so many products, because it will not, I may be able to supply you the equipment, but overall per kg of processing cost will be higher and you will not be competitive in the market considering the logistics cost and other energy cost and investment cost.
Okay. Question from Mr. Amol Patil. Neologic has been supplying complete dairy projects. While deriving such projects, how do you take care of utility part? What are the key deliverables to conserve energy, specifically for steam and water?
Yeah. Since we are very much related to the core area of dairy processing, dairy processing cannot work without proper and reliable utilities. So we also ensure whenever we take up a project, greenfield or brownfield project, we also do our own analysis of the available utilities, or if it is a greenfield project, then we work with your technical team to arrive at proper specifications and proper sizing of your utilities. And when it comes to the planning in equipment planning and pipe routing planning and everything, we work closely with your other utilities or partners or suppliers, so that the end result has to be aesthetically and hygienically good. Because if we work in isolation, then many times it happens that the stainless steel piping has come out very nicely, but a steam supplier, who is a FBR approved vendor, has done a very different job. And then refrigeration supplier independently has worked and he has put his own supports, and end result is not so good for the customer in spite of spending a good amount of money. So we integrate those designs in our system, and we guide those suppliers to do that kind of installation and fill up the gaps. If customer has a specific requirement, we also supply utilities, complete package, including refrigeration, boiler, and everything.
Yes. Last two questions now. Yuvraj Patil, in modernization, what is the important factor to be considered? Quality or cost? How both impacts, or as both are dependent on each other?
And definitely, quality comes at cost, you know. And we have to define our acceptable limit of quality. And for that acceptable limit of quality, we should be ready to incur that cost.
Next question is from Sanjay Barua. In aseptic milk plant, due to sudden failure of power, once aseptic mode is lost, then the entire batch production is to be drained out, which is a huge loss. How can we overcome that?
Basically, we should have a UPS for such things, because aseptic tank doesn't consume very high power, to be frank. The power consumption is quite less, and we should have proper UPS for the control system, as well as we should have proper backup for the steam barriers and proper backup for the pressure supply. Things we have to ensure acidity in an aseptic tank.
Last question.
Power, air, and steam.
Yeah. Last question coming up from Srinandan Sharma, SR Thorat Milk Products. These days, yeah. Greek yogurt is gaining popularity. Do you provide technology and complete setup for that?
Yes, Sharma sir, Greek yogurt is quite popular, but considering the present volume, the batch sizes are quite small. We have technology, but that technology can be used for larger batches as well as smaller batches. You have to do your own calculations as to what maximum batch size you can go for.
I think that's one it.
Question about density of milk.
Sorry?
Yeah, there is one question about aniline density of milk. Yes, it is quite common to measure the density of milk.
Yes. Okay. So I think that's it for today's seminar or today's webinar. Thank you, all the attendees, all the panelists, for your kind contribution. And definitely, we will be getting in touch with you. And you, I'm sure that you must have already noted our email address, our phone numbers, and mobile numbers. And we look forward to your attendance in upcoming webinars once again. Thank you all.
Thank you all attendees for your overwhelming response. And I look forward to see you soon with different topics. And thanks for remaining connected. Bye-bye.